We gotta talk about this movie you're in called Nimona. Congratulations on going from YouTube to a big Netflix movie. You're in there playing Sir Ambrosius Goldenloin. Why is your last name Goldenloin?
I think it's exactly as it sounds.
Okay, all right.
I think the pun's in the name.
Hey everyone, my name is Philip Wang. Welcome to another episode of Spill the Boba Tea, a show where I get to bring friends over to Bopomofo Cafe to make a drink that's based on my guest's life and career. I'm so excited for today's episode because for the first time, we have a fellow YouTube creator who is making the incredible jump to Netflix in their groundbreaking new animated film, Nimona. He has impacted millions of people around the world. Please welcome Eugene Lee Yang.
That was titillating.
Say that again.
That was titillating.
Oh. Eugene, I started off as a fan of you. I still remember the first time I met you. Probably don't remember because so many people come up to you. And you were there, and I'm like, oh my God, that's Eugene. He's so cool. And since then, we've become friends. We've shared drinks. We've shared stories and gossip. And now we get to share boba. Actually, technically we have shared boba before. I've been on your channel.
That's true.
Now you're on my turf.
So now you're gonna poison me.
Well, we're gonna get into that. We're gonna get into that whole experience for me. This show is all about your life, and every ingredient is my interpretation of some stage of your life.
Wow, okay. Poetic.
We're gonna start off with where you grew up, which is Texas.
That's right.
And as we know, everything is big in Texas. So for the first time ever, we're making a punch bowl.
I love a good old punch bowl.
The reason also that there's grapefruit is, did you know that the state fruit of Texas is the grapefruit?
I 100% did not know that.
So you grew up in Texas, but Pflugerville?
Pflugerville. Yeah, I was born in Waco.
Yeah.
And then I moved to Pflugerville when I was about 2. And so I'm older than a lot of people assume. I'm 37.
That Korean skin regimen, guys.
And you're about my age, right?
Yeah, I'm 38.
That's right.
Look at the difference,
That's
guys.
That's right. No. Look at the difference. No, the difference is you're wearing makeup. No.
Could you feel that you're the single only Asian?
Like, absolutely.
You could feel
it. Yeah, we were probably most people in that town's first experience to anyone out from outside of country even.
That's wild.
There weren't even many like immigrants besides like the Mexican American population.
Right. So I assume that there was like probably a lot of ignorance about just what you were.
There was,
foreigner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I try to have a much more mature perspective about my childhood.
Sure.
There was a time where, you know, certainly when I left and went to college, my sisters and I had that rage period where we looked back and we were really resentful. But I kind of have come to appreciate how much of my upbringing has shaped me, how much of it also was far more diverse than I even recognized in my later years. And now I kind of look back and I see, oh yeah, most of my community, you know, it was predominantly white, but there was a huge Latino population, huge black population.
Yeah.
Maybe I was the only Asian, but I wasn't the only Asian culture bringing something new to the table.
I see.
Although I did feel othered a lot,
now
I like to tell people that what you see is basically a face of Texas.
Right.
It has a very diverse population, second most diverse in the country.
You have a lot of Texas pride. What part of you is like the most Texan?
If we're talking stereotypically, I actually would say my most Texan trait is I am friendly to a fault.
That's not your character.
No. Yeah. People assume I'm intimidating, and then when they meet me, they're just kind of blown away at how chatty and personable I tend to
be. That's very Southern.
I really like jumping into conversations. My parents always said that I could make friends with a wall.
Do you talk to your Uber driver?
Yes. That's like the level. I talk to anybody.
You know, like there's an option of like, do you want to talk?
I talk to TSA agents. I talk to anyone who wants to have a conversation with me.
That's amazing.
But you know, I was also a lonely kid, so.
Did you have a cowboy hat and all those stereotypical things too?
You know, not like full Minotti level. Okay. But I did have Western wear growing up.
Okay.
And now I kind of reclaimed it just because I feel like it's really important. That's why I'm wearing some denim right now.
Right. Did your family, like being Korean immigrants, did they push to like adopt more white culture? Was it like, hey, we gotta make sure we go trick-or-treating with the rest of the kids. We gotta drink eggnog at Christmas time. Like,
the truth is, I think my parents really wanted to survive first and foremost.
Right.
And my parents are really savvy, my mother especially. She has a lot of social graces. Mm. So she kind of immediately clocked and understood the environment that we were thrust into. And she did everything in her power, not necessarily to assimilate us, but make sure that we weren't seen as people who could be lower in the pecking order.
Oh,
so it was okay. The small things. Like, yeah. She dressed us really well, which is why I have an interest in fashion. Mm. It's not like we didn't have very much money.
Right.
But she wanted people to think that there was an illusion. I remember kids used to come to our house and be like, wow, I thought you lived in a two-story house. A two-story house was rich in my neighborhood.
Oh.
But no, they were always surprised that we were much more humble.
So yeah, your mom definitely was keeping in mind, like, kind of your place and how to insert and raise the kids in an environment that, yeah, you guys would not feel like you're lower than others.
Yeah, she wanted us to feel empowered. Yeah. And I mean, I dealt with a lot of bullying when I was a little kid.
Yeah.
I am happy to say that, you know, I was able to rise out of that.
Yeah.
But I would say a lot of that came from the confidence that my parents were able to instill. And I think a lot of that was part of their Korean pride.
Yeah.
But it was translated into Texan. Does that make sense?
Well, I mean, Korean pride probably mixed with Texan pride.
That's a dangerous combination.
Well, this is perfect segue because I wanted to ask you about how, like, you preserved your Koreanness in Texan.
Yeah.
And our next ingredient actually is pear juice.
Mm.
But not just regular pear juice.
Mm-mm.
What kind of pear juice do we get?
You got the Korean pear. Damn.
Well, here's the thing. There's the Asian pear that everyone talks about, but then Koreans always love pointing out. No, but the ones at the Korean market, the Korean pear is very different.
It is different.
Sure, whatever you say.
It's like the tap water in New York.
How did you stay close to your Korean heritage then? How did you find that balance then?
So much of it was both exposure between family traditions, mm-hmm. you know, because that can't ever die out.
Yeah.
That's just ingrained, and whether it was conscious or subconscious for my parents, it was always present.
Yeah.
I was also raised Presbyterian, so we did drive like an hour to go to the to the Korean church in Austin.
That's very Minari, actually.
Very beef.
Yeah, very beef too, yeah.
Didn't really help with my other stuff, but
we'll get into that later, yeah.
Right. It was nice to be able to have some form of community where I didn't have it immediately available around me.
Right. So you had like the church and obviously your parents, but do you remember the first time you saw Korean media and like, or what Korean media stood out to you? What Asians in even Western media was your first exposure?
I always point out Trini from Power Rangers. That was probably my first real exposure to an Asian person.
Yeah.
And that's technically Japanese media.
Right.
So it was a pretty big thing for me. And then on the opposite side, I watched a ton of anime.
Oh, he's a man of culture. Anime.
Yeah.
Anime.
Yeah.
not anime.
Is that pretentious?
No, it's not.
It's hard because you don't want him to go like, oh, I went to Bali.
But okay, go on. So what were your top hits?
I mean, I was a classic like Dragon Ball kid.
Of course.
Sailor Moon.
Yeah.
And then Cowboy Bebop sort of opened my eyes.
Okay.
And I was really into a lot of Miyazaki.
Yeah.
And then I don't know if anyone else had this experience, but there were these VHS, probably for a lot of foreign language communities.
Yeah.
But there were all these VHS stores.
Oh, of course.
Sometimes they were connected to like the back of a grocery market.
Yeah, the video stores for
sure. Yeah, so my dad would go and
all the bootleg stuff. You know, that arms loads of VHS.
Yeah. I remember Shiri.
I'm not gonna know, man.
You should see it. It was like from 1999. It's a female assassin.
Are you gonna give me the VHS tapes?
Yeah, I'll find you the VHS tape.
Or the Laserdisc. Maybe those exist.
But he was watching a lot of stuff that, you know, around the same time, I was being exposed to things like Hong Kong cinema. So I loved Wong Kar-wai, and I loved Ang Lee. Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, when that came out, was hugely formative for me.
Why?
In terms of seeing Asians on screen in the cinema.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Because it was an international
hit. It was an American
release. I saw
that
7 times in the theaters.
Dang.
I was obsessed.
Wow.
Being able to see even glimpses of that when I was, you know, a young teenager,
like
Park Chan-wook, seeing his first films through my dad, sticking like,
at
that point, the DVD into, into the TV. That was big for me and as a kid, because, you know, a lot of my exposure was Western art and media. So, you know, it was always present in its own ways.
Right. You're clearly very well-versed in film cinema, and that was in your DNA. You were destined for this because you chose a paintbrush at your goal.
How'd you know that? What did I say? Did I say that in an interview?
This show, we go deep. You chose a paintbrush.
Yeah.
So arts was always in your future. You went into theater, choir, dancing. Mm-hmm. You were the triple threat into high school, and it led you to USC.
Yes.
And this leads us to our next ingredient. Believe it or not, we have a USC-themed ingredient.
Money.
We're just
I got student loans.
Rubbing her face in like dollar
University bills. Of spoiled children.
So, as we know, USC's mascot is?
Trojans.
All right. The Trojans, their empire, do you know where their empire predominantly is?
It was in near ancient Greece.
Turkey, correct.
Turkey.
And the main export of Turkey is?
Apricots.
We have an apricot jelly here.
Yeah.
This is gonna be our
topic. That sounds delicious.
You did dance, you did theater. Why film? Why did you go into film school out of all these different mediums of art?
I didn't have film immediately available to me where I grew up. Your only options were like
computer class.
Or being tech in theater.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And I was too like, look at me to do that. What really brought me over to filmmaking was I had an incredible teacher in seventh grade, Mrs. Kohler.
It's always the teachers, man.
It's always the teacher.
Teachers.
Respect your teachers.
Yeah.
She held me after class one day, and she slid over this Entertainment Weekly article that she clipped out herself, and it was about Matt Damon and Ben Affleck.
Yeah.
And it was right after they got nominated for an Oscar for Good Will Hunting.
Good one, okay.
And so she said, that's you.
Wow.
And I said, a white man from Boston?
I was like.
Yeah, she said, you're so like multi-talented in regards to your interests that although you don't have, you know, access to a film camera here, your visual arts, your dance, your choir, your theater backgrounds all can combine to be perfectly coalesced under the filmmaking umbrella. Right after that happened, I told my parents, I'm gonna go to film school, and my mom looked it up, she printed up a list, and she saw, number one, USC, do it. People often ask, were your parents supportive of you being artistic? I often joke that they didn't think I could do anything else well.
But no,
but they did recognize, yeah, and looking back, you know, I think that the stereotype of Asians not supporting art, I think there's kind of a misconception there.
I agree.
My parents really supported me in everything I did. They were at every theater show, they were at every choir performance, and they believed wholeheartedly that I could be a successful director and a writer.
Yeah.
But they just reminded me that it would help if you could also prove it, right?
Yeah.
That was my version of strict Asian parenting.
Yeah. Those years after film school,
when
you were trying to figure out what you were as a filmmaker, go mainstream, and you were kind of flirting with or entering like the digital space, let's talk about that for a little bit, because that is actually the inspiration for our next ingredients.
God, you wrote this well, Phil.
Because what we have here, this is where it gets fun. We got a little bit of rum. And you know, when you drink sometimes, you get a little buzzed.
Mm-hmm.
And you worked at a place called Buzzfeed.
Oh God.
Okay, the real reason why I brought out the rum though is because we heard that you love Rihanna. Or Rihanna.
Oh, I do.
We heard that you love Rihanna.
Riri.
And Barbados. So we got to get some rum up in here.
I mean, if it's Riri dedicated, I'll drink it.
It is Riri dedicated. But you joined Buzzfeed in 2013. And I know that being a huge personality was not really part of your plans.
No.
So how did you kind of navigate that role or that identity shifting from this filmmaker that you were trying to be, this auteur, whatever, artist, to, oh, I'm making YouTube videos?
There was a lot of soul searching going on under the output of hundreds of videos.
You made so many videos.
I made so many videos.
Yeah.
I was 28 when I landed that sort of just full-time gig.
Right.
Because prior to that, for 5 years, I was waitering.
5 years is a long time.
Yeah, I was a waiter, making ends meet, and directing music videos and commercials here and there, applying to like Sundance Labs, doing the sort of
the
classic filmmaker
way.
And I needed a full-time job, and they had just started their video department.
Okay.
So I was one of the first cropping of producers there.
Yeah.
And that's when they were also figuring it out. So I was hired as an intern, but then I was put full-time like within a couple months.
Right.
Because I had no idea, even when signing up for the job, that I would be on camera.
Were you resistant to it at first?
I thought it was strange.
Right.
And I didn't want to embarrass myself, which you can see my ass on there right now. Like, come on. A lot changed within a few years.
Was there a moment where you're like, I guess this is, I'm just gonna lean in or just get into it?
I treated it as if it was its own film project. Reaching this huge audience in the blink of an eye is a pretty special thing. The platforming of that is really unique. So being able to technically and theoretically experiment with that was fascinating. It was interesting. It remains to be fascinating.
Right. As an artist and a creative, like that's very gratifying for sure.
Yeah, and I would say, like, you know, looking back, I didn't agree with everything that my former employer did. They were chasing the widest and sometimes, in my opinion, the lowest common denominator, which has its own value.
Right.
My mantra always was quality over quantity growing up, but I chose to take it as a challenge.
Yeah. The thing is though, that you still found a way to make very impactful pieces that were these standalone art forms and films that like were very much different from the normal slate of stuff that was on BuzzFeed. I think that's why you stood out so much.
So I think what I've had to like really realize is that there was a long time where I was trying to like force this idea of authenticity. And at the same time, then that comes with the baggage of, but then what will this group of people think if I'm not this way? And the responsibilities of being a new Asian American face online, a new queer voice online.
Yeah.
I could be more bare, honest, and truthful through production that I knew how to push more of my perspective in ways I felt comfortable with than, say, podcasting. As both Asian Americans, as queer people, shift our identities. Again, it's
code switching.
It's a lot of it happens also with the platforms we deliver things on. I've found for myself that with the privilege of my personal life, that's happened less and less and less and less every year. Mm. Not everyone has that opportunity. Maybe their family or home life is less safe or more strict.
Right.
Maybe they don't necessarily want to be a certain way in front of their work friends. Yeah. But for me, I have always like led with this philosophy of less switching or covering of myself. And that actually, in a lot of ways, is the best way I found that I've been able to lead by example.
To you right now, like in the queer community, what are the biggest issues? And how do you think like being Asian specifically is separate from the overall issues that you guys are going through?
We need a lot of drinks for this conversation.
Oh man, well.
First, think about any sort of conversation you've had about being a cis, heterosexual, Asian man and how that journey of our, that portrayal in media and in society at large, in Western society.
It's already so complex.
It's already so complex. Yeah. I would say specifically for queer Asian men at this point in time is that we have to be way more open to this idea of gender fluidity and femininity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that people have seen me sort of express a lot of that through my fashion choices.
Yep.
That's where I personally feel quite freed.
Yeah.
But I do feel internally, I'm constantly fighting this like small, angry little man in my head who's saying, you know, butch it up, mask it up, be strong. And that comes from a lot of different elements, but I would say that probably the most informative of that actually is being Korean.
Yeah.
And it is wild to me that, you know, sometimes I actually feel the most scared to be overtly feminine is in an Asian dominant space.
Whoa.
I remember the first time I wore something that was really played with this idea of gender at one of the galas we go to.
Yeah, yeah.
It's, you know, all Asian American people. I was terrified.
Oh man.
Now you see me, I walk in and I'm just like,
you do not give a fuck now.
Hello. But before I was shitting bricks when I walked out there.
I love that you are this figure for the community. And the reason why I know so much actually is because I have interviewed you before in my book.
Yeah, look at that. That was smooth.
In my book, where he talks about his coming out story. This is how we know so much about you, because we've actually had this conversation before.
Yes.
It was during the pandemic. I don't exactly
remember. Yes. No. Check out his book. It's incredible.
Well, you know, to close out this very heavy but important segment, you know, you talked about these different identities that you're balancing. I got to ask about one identity that you have. You mentioned going out to the clubs and partying. I got to ask, who is Cheyenne Pepper?
Ah.
And what is the background of that name?
So Cheyenne Pepper is my drag persona.
Okay.
And she was when I first performed in drag for video.
Yeah.
And I got to be mothered by this incredible queen named Mayhem Miller. Hi, Mom. But Cheyenne comes out to play like occasionally. Because I'm not a true drag queen.
Yeah,
true drag artists are hard workers and they work every single night, every single day.
Yeah.
But Cheyenne Pepper, I didn't want to have the stereotypical like Asian pun name for as the queen.
No, that's a good call.
Like I immediately was like, I guess bibimbap?
Or kimchi kim.
So I wanted something spicy and southern, and actually my partner came up with that.
Okay. Well, because it's Cheyenne Pepper, in homage to her, do you know there's a city in the United States called Cheyenne?
Wyoming.
Very good. And do you know Wyoming's biggest export?
I'm gonna guess.
Go.
Open space.
Kind of, because it is actually hay. Did you know you have to grow hay?
The first thing you think of when you think of a wide open space is hay.
I thought hay is just when stuff dies, it becomes hay, but you have to grow hay.
I just knew hay bales. You just go sit on a hay bale.
So guess what?
A hay bale.
These straws are made of hay.
Really?
Like reed.
It's biodegradable?
Yeah. So we're gonna be drinking out of hay straws.
Smell like hay.
In honor of Cheyenne Pepper. Because it is, Cheyenne's the capital of Wyoming, in case you didn't know.
I've never been to Wyoming.
But Cheyenne Pepper should go to Wyoming. Eugene, right now, you're on my show Making Boba, and we gotta talk about the last time we made boba together. Well, technically, you made boba for me, hard quotes.
Okay, I did it without a recipe.
I was on an episode of Try Guys Without a Recipe,
uh-huh,
where you tried to make me a boba drink, and it was completely undrinkable.
Yes.
It was hard to even look at.
Uh-huh.
I gave you an Asian strike that day.
Yeah.
How did you mess up that
bad? It's probably 10 strikes for me. I already told you I put shoes up on the couch.
Oh Guys, leave a comment. Please tell them to stop bringing.
We are not a monolith.
Tracked in from the outside. Okay, so with the drink that you made for me on Without a Recipe used, do you remember the type of tea you used?
Pu'er.
Pu'er tea. And guess what? This is pu'er tea.
Yeah!
I'm gonna show you how to do it right today.
Hell yeah.
Okay, so we're gonna make
And this is famously, it tastes of twigs and nature.
It's very pungent. When we were making it, like, yeah, kind of smells like manure.
Have you tested this yet?
In small batches, not in this way. So we're gonna find out today. All right, Eugene. You are here today because we got to talk about this movie you're in called Nimona.
Yes.
Congratulations on going from YouTube to a big Netflix movie. I got to ask, like, you know, this is based on a very popular book. Were you already tracking this book, or was the first time you heard about it when you got the role?
N.D. Stevenson, he's an amazing storyteller, author, illustrator, created Nimona.
Yeah.
And I had read it when it was a graphic novel. I do remember really becoming familiar with Endy's work when he created and produced She-Ra on Netflix.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So I watch pretty much anything animated. If it's queer and animated, yeah, in front row seat center.
Does She-Ra count as a queer animated show?
It's like textbook queer.
Okay. All right, I'm gonna check it out.
So gay. Yeah. That's why I loved it.
What makes it so gay?
The gay people.
Oh, all right, I need to watch the show.
The history of animation is so queer.
Yeah.
I think it's the queerest medium.
Okay.
Because it was a way first you can see the queerness of animators coming out. People always say queer-coded Disney villains. I'm like, it's because the animators were queer.
Oh.
That's why they're so fabulous.
Right.
But then now where they're talking about representation for LGBTQ plus communities and where that feels the most vibrant and pushing the boundaries and authentic.
Yeah.
Look no further than like family animation.
Yeah.
It has, especially over the past few years, really exploded with actually being unabashedly queer.
That's amazing.
And Nimona, I think, is in line with a great tradition of that.
Yeah. And so
also like Sailor Moon.
I was a Venus guy.
Of course you were.
Why?
It's basic. I was a Mars girl. I mean, obviously. I also like Jupiter because she was.
What are you talking about? Not a tuxedo mask? Not a Darien?
No. So you gotta remember. When you're gay,
please educate me.
It's not necessarily the hot guy.
All right, I'm so sorry to reduce
the love action. Or identify with the most. It's the fierce girl. So
Stan.
I was a Sailor Very Mars good. Stan.
Got it.
Right?
Because you saw yourself
in her.
Got it.
And I also liked, I mean, obviously Uranus and Neptune, I believe, were actually a couple in Japan, but they changed it for the American audience.
They straight washed it.
They straight washed the hell out of it.
Well, your character in Nimona, first of all, why is this movie so important?
Well, I really think that we are living in a time where the conversation about real people's lives and their safety and a community's entire longevity, particularly within the queer umbrella, there's a lot at stake. And I mean that in a way where people are refusing to have the next step in understanding someone who might disagree with them. My whole life has been taking the extra steps to outreach, to bring someone, to build the foundation, to have a common understanding.
Yeah.
Or at the very least, so that group doesn't want my group to be eliminated or erased.
Right, at the very least.
And having films especially like Nimona, where it can speak to this idea of effortlessly portraying characters who inhabit those communities, but are also fully realized. And there's a lot of wonderful humor and action and adventure and genre bending and heart and darkness. There's complexity there, there's realness there. I think we need to see those reflections back at us because it's not just a angry yelling back at another side.
Yeah.
It's just an honest story.
Yeah.
And it's full of like wonderful character, heart, and insight and dynamics that feel like they could be both a part of anyone's experience, but specifically really a part of my experience as a queer person.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm very fortunate that the character that I portray is essentially a gay man.
Yeah.
There's really no ifs, ands, or butts about it from
some butts?
The jump. Mm. Well, a few butts.
A few butts.
But always a little butts.
Essentially,
oh, look at you, little coy boy.
Is your hope actually that some people will stumble on this movie thinking it's just like an action adventure film, and then realizing, oh, this is a gay story. Or actually, would you rather be very known? Let's please support this and everyone go please watch this.
I think both are valid. Just think of it like meeting me at a party. You could know something about them going in. Mm-hmm. You could know something, but as long as you engage in the conversation,
yeah,
it's great that you're there.
Yeah.
Being able to talk about it.
That's awesome.
So whether they go into seeing this film knowing elements that they're excited about,
yeah,
or being pleasantly surprised,
yeah,
both are fantastic. And I hope it creates more conversations.
I think there's gonna be a lot of people pleasantly surprised and a lot of people that are very happy that you're in there playing Sir Ambrosius Golden Loin. Golden Loin.
Golden Loin.
Why is your last name Golden Loin? Is it actually?
I think it's exactly as it sounds.
Okay, all right.
I think the pun's in the name.
Well, because your character is Golden Loin and has this beautiful suit of armor of gold. And
pun intended.
It's in the medieval times.
Yeah.
We're gonna be drinking out of these golden chalices today.
Ooh.
This is also a first. This is
real gold?
Yeah.
You got that real Netflix money.
Dude, we are not making any more episodes of this. This is the last one.
Wow.
It's heavy. That's how you know it's
not. That is heavy.
That's how you know it's not gold. So yes, we're gonna be drinking out of these golden goblets.
Wow.
All right, Eugene, as we wrap things up, you know, you got so much going on. You're, you know, going between, you know, the traditional, the digital side with YouTube still. Where's it all going? What are you working on right now? Is YouTube always gonna be a big part of your identity?
I am just extremely fortunate and privileged to be in the position I'm in. I'm sure you understand implicitly how we have these, you know, relatively giant platforms with lots of people who actually care about what we put out there. And
right.
I think that's such a blessed and unique space to be in.
Yeah.
And I certainly hope to continue speaking to those people as much as possible through my career.
Yeah.
I also know that sometimes what I want to say is a little slower, a little more carefully constructed, mm-hmm, and a little more time consuming than what people who might have followed me so far are used to.
Mm.
So I wish that they know that I still am 100% committed to being available whenever I can,
yeah,
especially in the digital space.
Yeah.
But you know, I am trying to build these big houses,
yep,
that are very queer
and
very Asian. One of them is a fantasy queer YA series.
What?
Which, let me tell you.
You're writing right
now? Writing fiction.
Yeah.
People are like, what are you doing? And I say,
I'm working on my novel.
What do you think I'm doing? I'm locked in a room for 24 hours writing.
Gosh. Okay.
But I love that.
Yeah.
I thrive off of that space creatively.
Eugene the author. Coming
yeah.
soon.
And then I also, of course, have really tried to make sure that my primary focus since I was a kid,
yep,
filmmaker, writing and directing,
of course,
is honored. So there's a lot of really exciting news I can't talk about yet that's on the way.
Well, I would assume that the first person in line to direct your own book would be yourself, so.
Oh God, I would never do that.
No. Well, maybe some other directors that you know
I'm gonna direct your life story.
Oh my gosh.
Who are gonna cast as you?
Let's just cast each other. All right, Eugene, it is time to assemble this punch bowl.
Let's cast Manny Jacinto. We need to cast Manny in more things.
Dude,
Manny is so nice.
Manny would be amazing.
I want to see Manny Jacinto in everything.
He's so fun to look at.
And now I'm turning you a little gay.
Hey, Jasper, I can appreciate good-looking, handsome
Hash.
Man. I'm secure in my sexuality.
That's
so,
right, yeah.
Come on.
Well, I'm glad you're a dad.
What we're going to do is we're going to fill this obviously up with some ice because we want this. This is a cold drink, okay? Number one. Eugene, please pour in our Korean pear juice.
How much?
The whole thing, bro.
Oh, fuck yeah.
This is Texas right here. Oh, yeah. Look at that stream. Look at that strong stream. All right.
And that's why they call me Golden Loin.
I'll do the pour. We're going to mix it all together.
Uh-huh.
Oh, my stream's not as consistent as yours. Mine's splashing. I'm getting too much splatter.
Yeah.
All right, Eugene. We're going to pour some for Riri over here. Eugene, because this is your show, you get to spike this as much as you want.
Please.
This is
drink responsibly.
Wait, this is very responsible.
Wait, can all cameras get on me real quick?
All cameras get on.
Yeah. You don't need a seatbelt. C cam. C cam. A cam. B cam.
Okay. Well, we have to.
Oh, God.
Drink
damn it.
That.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Hey, you know what? This is your drink, Eugene. And going.
Half oh, no.
Putting half the bottle
Did I ruin it?
You might have made it really good, actually.
Okay.
All right, let's put some actual fresh Korean.
Yeah, because that's gonna fix it.
Yeah. let's dilute a little bit. We got some,
we're
some
off
apricots,
the rails.
You know.
Okay.
Because of the apricot jelly, the Trojans.
Yes.
We're gonna put some of this apricot jelly into our cup.
Oh, you put it into the cup.
Yeah. Because it's topping, all right? Let's try to have some of this rum with some tea. I have no idea what this is gonna taste like now. Here, I'll pour for you. You pour for me, okay?
Okay.
I'm older than you, technically.
Whoa, do you see how Korean I just got?
Yeah.
And wow. I believe.
Oh, sorry, I'm not doing it good for camera.
Well, technically, I would be serving you because I'm the youngest.
You are the youngest, but it's okay. We're in America. I'll let it slide. Okay, here we go. All right. We got our Sir Ambrosia Golden Loin Chalice filled with our...
You don't look like you want to drink
poor,
this.
Poor punch.
Yep.
That's spiked with rum. Eugene, name your drink.
The Golden Loin.
The Golden Loin.
The Golden Loin.
The makes it fancy.
Well, because if we make it sound fancy,
okay,
it'll cover up how it tastes.
To the Golden Loin, to Eugene, to Nimona, congratulations on this film. It's so important and just really grateful that you got to be here, share your story with us. Thank you, Eugene. Can't wait to see so much more from you, bro.
And to you, Phil, for being such an excellent host.
Oh, wow.
And such a handsome man.
Are you trying to get back on the show?
No, I'm trying to get on Asian Bachelor.
All right, we're gonna make that happen.
Get Manny just interested in Bachelor. Oh my God. I'll be there in a heartbeat.
We ordered it.
All the women and the gays got really excited.
All right, cheers, man.
And everyone's loved everything you've made so far in this.
So far.
Okay.
Hey, the rum was not as much as I thought it would be, considering how much you put in there. You do not look satisfied.
No, it's good.
Well, you put in half a bottle of rum, bro. Oh, what is it then? The poor?
It's the jellies.
Oh. You know what? No. Stop. He's doing this on purpose to like get back at me for my reaction to his drink, which was warranted. This is actually delicious, and we can ask everyone. You are just trying.
You know, the rum actually tastes really good because the other ingredients were actually so sweet.
Yeah.
That I feel like it had less rum.
You're right. It cuts.
I actually
a little. Yeah.
Poured the right amount.
Yeah, I think so actually. Thank you again, Eugene, for coming here today and being an inspiration for this drink and an inspiration to so many people around the world. Cheers to Nimona. Please go watch it right now on Netflix streaming. Congratulations again.
Thank you so much, Phil. This was a lot of fun.
See you next time.
Are you talking to them or me?
You know, Asian Bachelorette, right?
Asian Bachelor.
Bachelor.
I want to be a contestant.
You're right, yeah.
And I want to be in drag and evil.
Got it.